love the music. The DJ is incredible.
The people are really awesome.
Shot. Sit down. Hand up. Pass out. Wake up. Hate it.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Alchemix. Today we're going to be taking a look at a pretty cool little piece of gear, and it is that. It's little. This is the DDJ 200. You can see here, it fits in a backpack. How awesome is that? I say this almost every dang video, but it's never been more true than now. Get yourself a deck saver for your gear. Deck savers are worth their weight in gold. They're the closest thing you can get to a one-time insurance payment, and lets you travel a lot more worry-free about your knobs and your hardware. So just do it. I ordered this deck saver before I actually bought the DDJ 200. I figured, you know, if I'm going to buy one, I don't want to wait for this thing to come in weeks later. I ordered it like the morning that I decided to go and grab the DDJ 200. Came in a few days later. It was like $39, one of the cheapest deck savers I've ever got. Totally worth it. So first thing you notice, it's crazy small, crazy lightweight. It's extremely stripped. This was obviously aimed at not even bedroom DJs. This is for like casual DJs who have been using like MIXXX, like free software, and doing everything on their laptops. This is designed to kind of like gently bring you into the world of hardware and controllerism. And it does an excellent job of doing that. It's got the basics and nothing else. It's got faders, some cue pads, some jog wheels, EQs. There's literally not even trim gain on it, which I kind of am upset about because I feel like that kind of forces you to add a mouse into your setup when if you're trying to go for a micro rig, kind of defeats the purpose to have to bring more hardware. The biggest indicator, in my opinion, that this is clearly aimed at intro DJs, not professional DJs, there is no sound card built into this hardware. It has no XLR outs. It has no RCA outs. It is entirely MIDI connected to this laptop here, and we're using the sound card in the computer to send that out to a mixer so that we can get professional level sound on a PA system. If you try and go directly out from your laptop into a PA system, it definitely suffers sound quality a lot. It's not a small amount of noticeable difference. It's pretty much required that you have some sort of audio interface or mixer in order to really up that sound quality to run over a full-size, decent professional PA without hearing some rather hideous distortion and loss in sound quality. So I'm a little screwed because I wanted this for a micro rig. And that is the smallest mixer I own is the Mackie Pro FX12, which is a huge tank, as you can see. If you have one of those little four-channel Yamahas or one of the tiny guys, you're definitely golden. You can avoid having to have a micro rig that's almost more complicated and bigger than just a standard DJ controller setup. I really don't own any other controllers anymore. I sold my SX2. Which is an incredible piece of hardware. I have no complaints about it whatsoever. I never really used Serato anymore. I never got a full license to Serato with the SX2. It's hardware locked. So I just didn't use it very often because I did get a full license to Traktor with my Z2. I did get a full license to Rekordbox with the XP1 here. So I let that one go and I haven't really missed it. I have an XDJ RX2, which is a standalone controller. And honestly, for most mobile gigs, I'm still going to grab that because the sound card on board sounds great. And it simplifies things when I can just directly out XLRs from my controller to my PA and not have to have this tangled mess. What this is great for is if I'm going to a venue where I know that they have a mixer and a house sound setup, and all I have to do is plug this directly into their setup, that's a super win. The other reason that I got this, like, true story, I've been doing a lot of DJ debuts, been helping a lot of young DJs get on the scene and kind of break out as all-star super DJs. And I don't want to have a bigger, fancier setup opening up for these people and hyping them than what they're playing on themselves. So this has been an awesome way for me to kind of keep it chill and open gently and then let them really shine and take the limelight. I mean, this thing literally makes a SB3 look like an extremely full-featured controller, like, in comparison. It's just so stripped back. But for me, like, that's what I like, is the essentials. I'm a very hands-on DJ, so jog wheels, faders, EQs, that's what I need, and that's what I play with. The line faders on this bad boy, they have great tension on them. It feels a lot like the SX2. The crossfader is nice and loose. The gate, however, is a little bit bigger than what I'm used to. I love inno faders. That is my weapon of choice. I swap that into almost any rig that I have if it's possible, and it's a tighter gap. It's got that crossfader curve that I like. However, I can absolutely live with this. It's not bad. Pioneer has always had good stock crossfaders. The jog wheels are awesome. They are tiny, but there really is no issue with the control on the jog wheels. Now, when I say this, I am specifically saying that in reference to the MIDI link setup I have here. I'm controlling Record Box with a MIDI link, and it is on point when it's hooked up to my laptop. I have also used this rig Bluetooth with my iPad, and there is definitely lag when you're doing DJ Pro, is what I've been using. It's just a little bit too much to really, like, juggle or cut with. So if you're trying to do that kind of stuff, make sure that you're using Record Box with a MIDI cable. I love being able to stream Spotify, but realistically, in this situation, what I did when I pulled this out last weekend, I still just use my iPad running DJ Pro independently, wired that through the mixer, had this set up separately, also wired through the mixer. It's just easier than having to worry about lag and stuff like that. You can still easily queue up your tracks and everything with the Bluetooth link. It's just for people like me who like to get hands-on in their performances, definitely isn't as tight. The cue buttons, these pads are plastic, hard plastic. They don't feel like MPC pads. Much more similar to the cue buttons on a CDJ. Hard plastic, very clicky, but they work. They're very accurate. There's no real latency issues or anything like that. So I don't complain about that too much. One thing I will complain about, both of these devices, the XP1 and the DDJ200, they are MIDI powered. There is no plug-in for power outside of just that MIDI cable. And in direct sunlight, I couldn't see a damn thing. I had no clue what track was queued, what pad mode I was in. I was continually, like, I was doing a rooftop party. I was continually putting my hands over the buttons trying to decipher what was going on because it just simply was not bright enough. And what kind of upsets me, when it goes into demo mode, the lights are much brighter. So I know it has the potential to shine a lot brighter. However, I have not been able to find anything that tells me how I can adjust the brightness settings on either of these two devices here. I don't know if there's a firmware update that could be done or if there is some sort of manual hardware setting I can change. I haven't figured it out yet. If that's something you guys are aware of, please leave me a comment down below. Tell me how I can crank the brightness on these rigs all the way up. On the CDJs, you can go into a utility menu. You have 5 different brightness settings. It's really nice. But in this situation, I haven't figured that out. The XP1 right here, it pairs so well with this piece of hardware. I bought this so that I could have the kind of digital features with DVS that I get out of a controller, but still have my full 12-inch control vinyl that I love so much. Luckily, since I already owned it and was a little frustrated, especially by the lack of a decoder for choosing tracks and load buttons, like I would absolutely hate to have to use my mouse to drag and drop tracks into my software. That's just a huge pain in the butt. It still kind of upsets me that I have to use the mouse to adjust trim knobs, but really it's better to just kind of set it up with a bunch of headroom and then use your line faders on a rig like this. So I'd highly recommend, if you don't own an XP1 and you're interested in the DDJ 200, consider getting an XP1. I realize it's an extra $100, but it comes with the license 2 record box. You get a full proprietary copy of record box with an XP1, which you do not with the DDJ 200. You don't get the full software, which in my opinion, that's what makes the XP1 really worth it. You get a lot more than just a box full of pads. So the jog wheels, they're amazing. The filters, they don't sound as good to me. There's definitely something about not having a sound card on board that, in my opinion, the high-low pass filter loses something in there, unfortunately. The EQs still seem on point. Can't complain about that too much. But overall, like anything you could do on an SX2 or a DDJ 1000, you can do on this. It's definitely a little more tight, a little more hectic trying to spin a tiny wheel and stay as accurate. But like really, you don't really lose anything in translation. It's totally a fun little micro rig to play with. So yeah, I can attest to you that this thing is very awesome, just as much fun to play with as a much bigger, more full-featured controller. And if you get creative, you don't have to sacrifice those features. There's combinations of gear and options that you can still do all your tricks. A lot of these effects that we have in the software, they're just based off maneuvers that turntable DJs used to do by hand. So if anything, it's going to help teach you how to do manual echoes, how to do manual delays, how to do beat juggling and loop rolls like with your hands, which is an excellent thing. I always tell people, like, if you know how to do it with your hands, you're going to know how to apply it so much more properly, and it just isn't like you're just pushing buttons hoping that everything sounds right. You know when and where to apply it, and it's gonna sound like you're a much more seasoned kind of DJ. So this is something I would highly recommend for DJs who have large equipment and are trying to find a way to do more mobile gigs without having to pack out way too much crap. And this is something I would recommend for people that have no hardware yet and are interested in getting involved with it. Me, I haven't tried the cell phone app. I've seen a lot of mixed reviews on it. To be honest, I'm not too terribly excited about the idea of DJing with a cell phone, so I'm not likely to really get into that at all. My big appeal with the iOS devices was just really streaming through Spotify, which I do. I almost always have that off to the side set up in my rigs for live requests. That's really the big appeal of it for me. So I think it's a big win. I think Pioneer did something awesome here. $150. That's like the cheapest Pioneer gear perhaps in the history of Pioneer ever. They love to make crap that is ridiculously priced. And this is a good indication to me that they're trying to reach markets that previously that just weren't really able to justify dropping the kind of cash Pioneer thinks that we all are going to just fork over. So I love you guys. Make sure you keep practicing, keep spinning. Leave me some comments if you have any clue how to increase the brightness on these bad boys. That would be amazing. And I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Thanks for watching.